Good morning, everybody. Happy Father's Day to the fathers out there. I am thankful for my father. He has gone on to be with the Lord, but I do appreciate and thank him for the godly influence that he was on my life, and a lot in the ways of music that I won't go all that into right now. But anyway, I do appreciate that. Fathers, you make a great impression on your kids, so keep that in mind. We're going to stand together as we begin this morning and sing together, "He is Exalted." All right, Carol?
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but
be seated for just a few moments. Now we're going to hear from Amy Legate and her son Austin. It's good to hear from them. We haven't heard from them for quite a while, and hope we're going to get back in the routine of having some more people up here and stuff. But Amy, Austin, it's good to have you guys singing for us today. God bless you all. And I'm not leaving. I'm just going to the back to help out for a second.
Thank you. Hello. There we go. Okay, this song is Fires by Jordan St. Cyr. It's been out for several months, but I heard it this winter driving to work one morning on, I don't know if it's K-Love or 88.5, and I just love the song. Also, it made me think of all the times in my life, and I know everybody out here has had fires in their own lives, but when I was going through one of mine, I had a postcard that I had handwritten a verse from 1 Peter that talked about proof of your faith and being tested by fire. And so anyway, that it kind of resonated and hit home with me. I also have my son, I guess Tom's not in here this service, but son Austin is assisting today. He's doing most of the hard playing because all I can really do is chord. So anyway, I'm blessed to have him. He's going to be a senior this year, so I've only got one more year left with him. So I'm going to try to twist his arm a few more times maybe. Anyways, are you all tuned up? I remember how you told me that life may not be easy, and everything that I need you've already given me. I remember how you told me I can trust you completely. So why am I doubting when you prove that you'd fight for me? You walked me through fires, you pulled me from flames. If you're in this with me, changed by your mercy, covered by your peace, living out the victory doesn't mean I won't feel the heat. You walked me through fire,
higher than it feels like I these fires, 'cause you're walking with me.
Thank you, Amy and Austin. Indeed, the Lord is there to walk through the fires with us. Amen. He never turns his back on us. He's always there, whatever it is we're going through. Although we may sometimes feel like we're in it alone, we never are. So praise God. I'm going to ask you to stand once again, and we'll sing together, Same Power.
I can see the waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. Can face every fear of the unknown. I can hear all God's children singing out. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. Same power that rose Jesus from the grave. Commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm the raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. Promises are true. In his strength there is nothing we can't do. Yes, we know there are greater things in store. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm the raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us. Victory, oh, in victory.
does live in us today. Hallelujah. Read to you real quick out of Joshua 24. And if you remember, Joshua was constantly reminding his people to stay firm in the word, in the ways of the Lord, and not take on the evil practices of the nations around them. And he's nearing the end of his life, and he has these words to say in chapter 24, verse 14. He says, straighten up here for me. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Joshua was taking a firm stand there to say that, you know, no matter what happens around me, I'm going to stand firm in the Lord, and so is my household, teaching them the ways that I should. And I just want to encourage fathers here today especially, but moms, and some of you are the heads of your household, maybe just raising children on your own, but especially dads, today being Father's Day, I want to emphasize this, that we are to step out as spiritual leaders of our homes. And those, you know, sometimes we fail. We're to continue to strive to do what the Lord would have us to do in His eyes, being constantly aware that our children and others are watching us and following in our footsteps. And I just, like I mentioned earlier, my dad was a good influence on my life. But not everybody has had that good influence from their father. But everybody has a good heavenly Father, and we can look to Him for perfection and for someone who will never fail us, never turn His back on us, and hurt us. He always has our good in His mind. And so I just want to encourage you in that. We're going to sing a song that we haven't done before. It's called As For Me and My, from that scripture. All right.
Your love, O Lord, is strength to my soul. Hope for tomorrow, it won't let go. Your presence is the joy of my life. To you I lift my eyes. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will sing of your love forevermore. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, serve the Lord. Your word alone, a lamp to my feet, a light to my path as you're leading me. Your ways, O Lord, are higher than mine. To you I lift my. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will sing of your love forevermore. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, serve the Lord. For me and my house, we will serve.
the nations bow and bring you praise. Victorious, you reign victorious over sin, over death, over all, over us. And with the angels we will sing a blessed multitude of your creation, rejoicing with the Holy King, the only one that brings us our salvation.
Worship you. Children's Church? Okay, that was your chance to escape. You better go now. There they go. Take your Bibles and turn with me once again to the, or turn with me to the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. Get your outlines out. If you're joining us online, I hope and pray that you've downloaded the outline. This morning, we're going to continue the series we started last week. Last week, we started looking at lessons from the Lord's life. We we started just looking at some of those events that took place in the life of Jesus that oftentimes we just kind of put in the category of historic filler or transitional statements that move us from one phase of his ministry to another. Last week, we went with Jesus into the wilderness, and we looked at the temptation of Christ in the wilderness, and we discovered that temptation actually has something to say to us. It's not just preparing him for his ministry, but it actually speaks to us. We learned the true nature of temptation last week, and we learned that Jesus was tempted, and the ways that he's tempted are the same ways that you and I are tempted. What we discovered last week was that we're tempted like him to change our priorities, to reorder our priorities. When Satan came to him and said, turn these rocks into bread, it was a temptation to put his physical existence above his spiritual life. And Jesus said it'd be better for me to starve to death and to die hungry than it would be to damage my relationship with my Heavenly Father. We looked at the next temptation that came to him, and we discovered that it was about accepting showy religion instead of substantive religion. That it was all about the show. Satan took him up into the pinnacle of the temple, and he said, just, you know what, you trust God. Just show everybody how much you trust God. Step off the temple. Just jump off. God will take care of you. Just show him everything. Show everyone. And it was all about show. And we've gotten caught up in that in the church. We think that it's the most dramatic expressions of our faith are the most dramatic things. And so we have these guys slaying people in the spirit, and we have the faith healers. We have all those kind of things taking place. And Jesus' response was, the word says you shouldn't test God. He said, you got to take the whole of Scripture. You got to get to the substance of Scripture, not just one or two ideas, but the substance. Then we also learned that there's no shortcuts to a meaningful life. Satan took him up on the mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world, remember? And he said, all this will be yours if you just bow down and worship me. And Satan was offering him a shortcut. He was saying, you can have everything you came for, and you can avoid the cross if you just worship me. But listen, there's no shortcuts. Jesus said, you worship the Lord and you serve him only. That was it. Well, today we're going to go to another one of those historic moments. Today we're going to move to another famous event, another event that's familiar to us all, the Mount of Transfiguration. Most of the time when we study the Mount of Transfiguration, we see it as preparatory for Jesus to go to the cross. Or we see it as Jesus trying to reassure that inner circle of those three men. But I want to tell you today that there's something even more significant to that account. Now listen, I'm going to give you the big idea, and then you can fall asleep if you'd like to. But we're going to be digging into this thing together today. The big idea is this. The time that you spend alone with Jesus is the most important time of your life. Let me say that one more time because I think you need to hear it. The time that you spend alone with Jesus is the most important time of your life. It is. It simply is. We're going to learn that as we look at the mysteries of the mountain. Mark chapter 9, beginning in verse 1. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it so I know we're ready to read. Get your outlines out. We'll be working on them together as we look at the great mysteries revealed on the mountain. Listen to what it says, beginning in verse 1 of chapter 9. And we're just going to read down to verse 10. Listen to what it says. And Jesus said to them, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God after it has come with power. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves and was transfigured before them. And his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. One of the other gospel writers tell us they were actually talking about his demise, his death. Literally, the word that's used there is his exodus, his departure from this earth through the cross. And so we continue. And they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, verse 5, Rabbi, it's good that we are here. Let's make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus charged them to tell no one what they had seen, until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. And so they kept this, the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead might mean. Now, normally when we read this this phenomenal passage of Scripture, this unique story, there's this unique account, we get caught up and we want to ask questions about why these three particularly. Why Peter and James and John? Why were those the only three that were there? Not all the disciples got invited up on the mountain. We want to know, what is this glory that they saw? What is this transformation, this radiance that suddenly appears on him that turns his, that starts with his face and then turns his clothes white? What is that about? What do we discover here in this passage? This is, in fact, a mysterious mountain. I feel like a geography teacher. Last week we were in the wilderness. Today we're in the mountains. So we're going to just continue to make progress. So get your outlines out. Let's work on them together. Let's think about this together. The great mystery is revealed on the mountain. Number one, the first thing, great truths are revealed when I spend time with Jesus. Great truths are revealed when I spend time with Jesus. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. Here's the very first thing that we discover. Great truths, great spiritual truths, are revealed not in a massive audience, not in a great group of people, not in a huge crowd, but great truths are revealed when I spend time alone with my Savior. When I spend time alone with Jesus. Listen, I wish I could tell you, if you'll just come to First Baptist Church and you listen to me preach, then I will reveal great truths to you. But the reality is, God has called me to put a rock in your shoe. God has called me to plant a seed in your heart. God has called me to rub you just a little bit the wrong way. But great truths will take place when you take whatever it is that you're here, whatever is planted in your heart, whatever pebble is in your shoe, if you'll think about that through the week, when you're alone time with God, then something will happen and perhaps you will discover a great truth from the Heavenly Father. You see, these were three men that got to go with Jesus. Not everybody experienced that truth. There were others, disciples. You know, there were 12 in all. 9 other men that Jesus had called out, that Jesus had chosen. They were never exposed to this experience because they were not alone with Jesus. The most significant time that you can spend in your day, the most significant time that you can spend in your week, the most significant time that you can spend in your life is time spent alone with Jesus. These men went up into the mountain with him, and it was going to be there that they would experience, that they would see, that it would be revealed to them these great truths about who Jesus was and what he came to do. It was their time alone with Jesus. The reality is that it's our time alone with him that will make all the difference. Great truth is revealed when I spend time alone. At my house, I'm the breakfast cooker. Anybody know what that's like? I get up every morning. I'm the first one up. Yep, I'm the first one up. You know, I put the coffee pot on, and I don't mean a Mr. Coffee. That's not good enough. We got an old electric percolator, you know, and you can hear it bubbling. Bloop, 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 bloop. And then suddenly the aroma starts filling the air, and you smell that fresh, perked coffee. Your mouth watering just a little bit. It gets better. Then I break out the skillet, and I put it on the stove, and I take bacon. I know God loves me. He created bacon. I take that bacon, I lay it in the skillet, and it begins to fry up, and that juice begins to flow, and the aroma begins to fill the air. Let me tell you, smelling the coffee is not as good as tasting the coffee. Smelling the bacon, not nearly as good as tasting the bacon. Listen, all that I do is the aroma. Spending time with him, that's the taste. That's the difference. That's the key. These three guys, for some reason, were chosen to go up on the mountain. And it was in that alone time with Jesus that great truths were revealed to them. It is in our quiet times, our alone moments, when it's just me and God, when it's just you and the Lord, that's when the seed will take root. That's when the rock will make sense. That's when we will grow in our understanding of who he is. Your time spent with him is the most important time of your life. Second thing, second truth that we find, this mystery revealed on the mountain. Number two, great experiences are mine when I spend time with Jesus. What an experience for those three men. They saw, now notice what happens. Mark is really interesting because he ties verse 1 and verses 2 and 3 together very, very closely. Listen to what it says. Let me read it to you. And he said to them, "Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God after it's come with power." And verses 2 and 3 say, "And he was transfigured before him, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them." They saw a fulfillment in verses 2 and 3 of what was prophesied in verse 1. Of what Jesus spoke in verse 1. Jesus said, "Some of you will not die until you see me in my glory." And so traditionally we've looked, and some people have actually said, "Well, you know, Jesus was mistaken. That's all about the second coming." But I got news for you. They had a very powerful experience up on top of the mountain. And they got to behold Jesus for who he really was. They got to see him in that moment in his glory. He radiated the glory of God. I read one commentary that said Jesus was on a promontory there out, and the clouds parted, and the sunshine came through, and it made him look shiny. Well, I got news for you. These men were outdoorsmen. These men were fishermen. They knew what it looked like when the sun broke through the clouds and began to shine. No, this was something that wasn't coming from outside him. It was something coming from within him. And there in that moment, when they were on the mountain, just the three of them alone with Jesus, they beheld him for who he was, as God himself and in all of his glory and his majesty and his radiance. They saw him for who he was. It is in my time when I'm alone with Jesus and in your time when you're alone with Jesus that we will truly begin to see him as he really is. That's when we will see him as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's when we will see him in all of his glory and all of his radiance. Listen to me. We have been churchified in this country in that most Christians believe that Jesus is their Savior, but just let him interrupt their lives because we don't claim him as Lord or as master. When we spend time with him, we begin to see him as he really is, as the great and mighty God, as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as the one with whom there is no equal at all. This passage of Scripture reveals these mysteries of the mountain, that there are great truths revealed when I spend time with Jesus, and great experiences are mine when I spend time with Jesus. I don't know about you. I'm starting to think I need to spend more time with Jesus. Third thing, number three, great changes are seen when I spend time with Jesus. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. Now you see, the danger we fall into here and the trap that we fall into is that we see this as an external kind of thing. We look at it and we say, "Oh my goodness, they could see Jesus and he was just as white as he could be. Everything about him was white, all of us." But you got to understand, since Adam walked on the earth, since Adam fell in the garden, mankind could only experience the glory of God by passing through the process called death. Death is the most unnatural thing in all of creation. God never intended for human beings to die. Death is the product of sin. We die because sin exists. And yet here on the mountain, the change that they saw was they saw one who stepped from this life into the glorious presence of God, and it reflected on his existence without going through the process of death. Now watch this. He stepped from life into glory without dying. Then he died on the cross so that you and I could experience, watch this, eternal life. Listen, one of these days, I'm going to lay down this physical body, But don't grieve for me, because I'm not lost, I'm not gone, I'm not dead. I am very much alive in the presence of my Heavenly Father, because Jesus stepped from life to glory to death to glory. Then I can go from this life to the next without missing a beat. That's the good news. That's the promise of the gospel. I don't go into a holding pattern. Put me in a high V bag and throw me in the ground, because I'm going to be dancing in heaven. Don't really care. But you learn that kind of stuff when you spend time with Jesus. That's the only way that you learn it. These men were up on the mountain and they experienced these great, great changes. Jesus broke death's grip on humanity, and now I can experience eternal life. Wow. What a mysterious mountain. What powerful words that can transform even us and give us hope and give us peace. Fourth thing that we discover: great challenges are met by focusing on Jesus. Oh, we still got lots to learn about this, folks. Listen to what happens. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses. They were talking with Jesus. And Peter enters the picture, and he enters like he always does, with a thud. He needs to remove his foot from his mouth. He says to Jesus, "Rabbi, it's good that we're here. Let's make three tents, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." For he didn't know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them. And a voice came out of the cloud, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. Peter enters the scene with a thud. And two others appear on the mountain, Moses and Elijah, the greatest lawgiver and the greatest prophet of all. They're there. But I want you to notice the challenge of life, the greatest challenge that you and I face is to focus on Jesus. Peter says, "Lord, it's good for us to be here. Let's build tents. Let's build you a tent. Let's build Moses a tent. Let's build Elijah a tent. You guys are equal." He recognized who they were. He recognized them as the greatest prophet and the greatest lawgiver. Peter knew who those men were. He recognized them. He says, "You guys are all equal, because we're going to build tents to all three of you." And then the voice spoke and said, "This is my Son. Listen to him." And when they looked again, there was no one there but Jesus. The great challenge of our life is not to build tents for anyone other than Jesus. Listen to me. CNN is not equal to Jesus. Fox News is not equal to Jesus. This church is not equal to Jesus. This preacher is not equal to Jesus. Your political party does not need a tent. Only Jesus stands alone as the one who deserves the tent, because he is the only one that is the beloved Son of God. Man, we learned some things on the mountain, that we're not to live our lives building tents to things that are not worthy. We don't build tents for our sports teams. We don't build tents in our lives for the things that we enjoy doing. We don't build tents in our lives for our possessions. We come and serve only one, the true and the living God. I'm like Peter. I like putting up tents. How about you? Got any tents you need to tear down? Got any things that you've built up, put on an equal level with Jesus? See, that's what Peter and James and John did. See, the reality is the greatest challenge of our life is to focus on Jesus, not on our problems, not on our circumstances, not on our difficulties, but to focus on Him. One more. Number five, the great principle is confirmed when I spend time with Jesus. Now notice what's going on. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. And so they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead might mean. Have you ever asked why these three? Why Peter and James and John? Why those three guys? Well, you know, traditionally what we've said is, well, they were the inner circle. They were the ones that were most intimate with Jesus. They were the ones closest to him. But I think we miss something when we go there. I think these three men, Peter and James and John, they had the most difficulty embracing the cross. If you go back to chapter 8 of Mark, Jesus begins to teach, I'm going to Jerusalem. I'm going to die. The third day, they're going to bury me, and the third day I'm going to rise. And Simon Peter grabs Jesus and takes him aside and says, Lord, that's never going to happen to you. You're not going to die. There's going to be no resurrection. You're not going that way. That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You don't know the will of God. You don't know what God is up to. You don't understand. They still don't understand. They're up on the mountain with him, and it says clearly, they didn't know what he meant by rising from the dead. You go over to chapter 10 in the Gospel of Mark, and you got Jesus again for the third time telling his disciples, I'm going to Jerusalem. They're going to crucify me. I'm going to die, and the third day I'm going to rise. And then right after that, James and John come to Jesus and say, Lord, when you come into your kingdom, let one of us sit on your right hand and the other on your left hand. And he tells them, you don't know what you're talking about. Listen, they weren't chosen because they were the closest ones to Jesus. They were chosen because they had the most difficulty accepting the cross. They were the most verbal objectors to the cross. They were the ones in that group of people that could not embrace it. Listen to me. Jesus came and went to the cross not so I could avoid it, but so I could embrace it. He died on the cross not so I could avoid it, but so I could embrace it, so that I would identify with his death, burial, and resurrection. In fact, the Gospel of Mark tells us that this is what Jesus said right after he had this discussion with Peter. He said, if anyone come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Folks, I hate to tell you this. Without the darkness of death, there is no radiance of resurrection. Without the cross, there is no crown. Without the death, there is no resurrection. These disciples were on the mountain because they struggled accepting that. And many of us still struggle accepting the fact that it required the death of Jesus for our salvation. We want to believe some way, somehow, that deep down, if we build the right tents and build enough of them, that we're going to be okay. But there's only one way. And that one way is through the cross. That one way is through what Jesus accomplished for us on the cross. There is no salvation without the cross. Jesus didn't go to the cross so I could avoid it, but so I would embrace mine and take it up and follow him. You know, it's Father's Day. Miss my dad. Thought on the way to work, on the way to church this morning, I thought, well, I wish I could hear my dad's voice again. But you know what? I'm confident I will. Because of this mountaintop experience. Because I know that Jesus went from life to death, that he stepped into glory. And I know that my Father is there with him. And that one day I will see Jesus. And one day I will see him once again. Here's the question. where do you stand when it comes to the cross? The mystery of the mountain ultimately focuses on Jesus. And only by spending time with Him will we ever take up our cross and follow Him. The most important time of your life is the time you spend with Him. So how can I become a follower of Christ? Three things have to happen. First, I've got to come to grips with the fact that I'm a sinner. I can't build enough temples. I can't build enough tents. I can't do enough good stuff. I can't do enough good works to ever earn my way into heaven. I've got to admit I'm a sinner. I'm broken, in desperate need of a Savior. I'm on a mountain terrified, just like these disciples were. And I need divine revelation. I've got to admit I'm a sinner. The Bible says, makes it clear, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us, myself included. Second thing, I've got to believe that Jesus was the Savior that I need. I have to believe that personally. That Jesus died on the cross for me. That the punishment that He took was punishment intended for me. That the blood He shed was a substitute for my blood. That He died in my place so that I could be forgiven. And then thirdly, and here's the discipleship part, I must commit myself to follow Him. That's where we take up our crosses. That's where we begin to follow Him. We take up our cross daily and follow Him. We take up our cross moment by moment and follow Him. Listen to me. That's more than sitting in church on Sunday morning. That's more than listening to me preach. That's more than putting an offering in the offering plate. Following Christ is about taking up our cross daily. It's about imitating Him. It's about believing that He did for us what He required of us, so He could forgive us and live in us and work through us. It's about becoming His disciple. I hope I'll put a rock in your shoe. I hope I'll put a seed in your heart. I hope I'll put a thorn in your side so that you go home and pray about and think about the teaching this morning. And that maybe in your time alone with Jesus, He will reveal to you great truths. Let's bow together.